Macmillan Audio presents Reykjavík, a crime story by Ragnar Jónasson and Katrín Jakobsdóttir. Narrated for you by Bert, Seymour and Tamaryn Payne.
Part 1. 1956. 6th of August. The grey hat flew out to sea. Christian had stepped out of the wheelhouse to admire the view over Flaxaflooi Bay and watch the island approaching, low and green against the backdrop of the mountains. When the squall hit the little fishing smack, he had reacted fast, but not fast enough, grabbing for his hat only to snatch at thin air. Though he'd have never admitted it aloud, he thought that it could have been worse. The hat, a Christmas present from his fiancée, hadn't really suited him. Now he would have an excuse to buy a new one. It meant he would be bareheaded for his visit to the little island of Videy, just off the coast near Reykjavík. But what did that matter, when the whole thing was bound to be a waste of time anyway? Still only in his 20s, Christian wasn't usually entrusted with anything important, but he was on duty this August bank holiday weekend as his superior officer was away. It felt as if the brief Icelandic summer was already over that August morning on the boat, with no shelter from the wind and the sun hidden by cloud. As there was no regular ferry service to the island, Christian had had to improvise and do a deal with an old fisherman he knew.
"Almost there, Christian,"
the captain called from the wheelhouse, his voice hoarse. Christian nodded, though there was no one to see, and did up another button on his overcoat to keep out the cold. If nothing else, at least the trip made for a change of scene, he thought, trying to look on the bright side. A woman, probably in her early 30s, was standing by the jetty to meet him. Christian had asked his fisherman friend to come back for him in an hour and a half. By the time he got back to town, the whole morning would have been spent on this visit. The woman held out her hand. "I'm Olive Blondell. Welcome to Videy." Her face was grave, and she didn't smile. "How do you do? The name's Christian," he said. There was something slightly off about Olive's manner, he thought. She looked a little shifty, yet at the same time he could have sworn she was relieved to see him. "It's this way," she said diffidently, and set off up the grassy slope from the jetty. He followed, noting that she had short red hair and was wearing a thick woolen jumper. Two striking white buildings with red roofs came into view between the island's twin green hills. The old Danish colonial mansion and the little church beside it. As they drew closer, Christian noticed how dilapidated they looked, the paint peeling from their walls and window frames. Beyond them, he noticed some tumble-down outbuildings, one of which looked like a cowshed, relics of the days where there was still a farm here. Halfway there, Olive stopped, turned and said, "We're not actually going there. My husband's at home. We live nearby." Christian nodded. "Does nobody—" She interrupted. "We have keys to the mansion, but no one lives there. It's a bit run down, but in pretty good nick, considering its age. It's 200 years old, you know. The oldest stone building in Iceland." "This girl, Lára—" Again, she cut him off. "It's best you speak to my husband." Christian walked along beside her, neither of them saying a word. There was a blustery breeze blowing on the island, but it was warmer than it had been on the crossing, despite the lack of sun. After they had been walking for a couple of minutes, he asked, "Excuse me, but you said you live here, you and your husband." "We moved here in the spring to a house that belongs to my family. We spent last summer here too. It's—" She paused. "There's nowhere quite like it." Christian didn't doubt it. The island was certainly a picturesque spot, its green meadows surrounded by the blue waters of the bay and set against the great hulk of Mount Esia. But Olaf's words lacked conviction to his ears. She went on awkwardly. It's not far to our house. It's more or less halfway between the mansion and the old school. As they walked, he let his mind wander. Being in the open air agreed with him, but he would rather have been spending this late summer's day doing something quite different. In recent years, he and a couple of old friends had taken up mountaineering in their spare time, inspired by the news 3 years earlier of Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay's conquest of Everest. While Christian had no hope of ever achieving those heights, he was making good progress. Only a few days ago, news had come in that the North Icelandic peak of Hraundrangi in Oxnadala had been climbed for the first time. Christian was acquainted with the two Icelanders who had made the ascent, along with an American. What he wouldn't have given to be there right now, rather than here in the tame environs of Videy. Still, gentle though the terrain was, he was careful where he set his feet as he picked his way over the tussocky ground. He remembered how his mother used to laugh and say that Icelandic men always walked as if they were stepping over tussocks, even when the ground was perfectly flat. But his main concern was to leave here without twisting or spraining an ankle, or dirtying his suit, for that matter. He owned 3 suits. The light grey one he was wearing now was the newest. The pinstripe was looking a little threadbare these days. And the black one he saved mainly for formal occasions, like funerals. An old wooden house appeared ahead, its black paint flaking. It had obviously seen better days. At that moment, an Arctic tern swooped over Christian's head, and he made a grab for his hat to ward the bird off, only to remember belatedly that the hat was now floating somewhere in the Flaxaflöi Bay. "Don't worry," Olaf said. "The breeding season's over, so it won't attack you." Her tone was momentarily lighter, as if she had forgotten that she was in the company of a policeman on duty. Her husband didn't come outside to greet them. Noting this, Christian wondered why it was Olaf who had been sent to meet him off the boat. Was this the way the couple normally did things? Or could there be something else behind it? "Come in," Olaf said, rather curtly, once they had reached the house. Christian entered a hall that turned out to be part of the sitting room. It was warm inside, almost uncomfortably so for the time of year. "Ottar," Olaf called. "Ottar, he's here." Christian heard a noise upstairs. Then footsteps boomed through the old wooden house. Without saying another word, Olaf walked into the sitting room and pulled out a chair from a large oak table, indicating that Christian should take a seat. He did so and waited. She sat down as well. "Good morning," said the man who had come down the stairs. "I'm Ottar. I take it you're Christian." "I am indeed. Thank you very much for agreeing to meet me. I only managed to explain briefly over the phone, but the thing is, we're worried about Lára." "She decided to leave," Ottar said flatly. "She gave up on her position here, I don't know why. We were so pleased with her at the beginning of the summer. She seemed hardworking and conscientious. Still, young people today." His face was expressionless as he produced this speech. Christian shot a glance at Olaf, who dropped her gaze. "How old was she again?" Christian asked, though he already knew the answer. 15, Olaf answered quietly. 15, Christian repeated. "And she decided to go back to Reykjavik, you say? Back home?" "Yes," Ottar replied. "When?" "On Friday morning. Naturally, I objected. We had an agreement that she would stay the entire summer as our help, but there was no talking any sense into her." Christian glanced at Olaf again. She was sitting unmoving, staring down at her hands. "As I mentioned on the phone, no one's seen or heard from her in Reykjavik." Christian left the words dangling as he watched their reactions. Olaf didn't raise her eyes. Ottar's face remained impassive. Maybe I should have put it differently. Did you see her leave on Friday? We can't see the jetty from here, Ottar replied. And it was hardly my job to give the girl a send-off. If people want to leave, that's their business, as far as I'm concerned. What about you, Olaf? Did you see her go? Olaf shook her head. I didn't see anything, she said, her words ringing a little hollow. How is she intending to get back to town?
I have absolutely no idea. She said someone would be coming for her, some friend or relative, I assume. I don't keep an eye on the boat traffic.
Do you have a boat of your own? Christian asked.
Yes, of course, Ottar said. But the girl didn't ask for a lift back to shore, and quite frankly, after the way she had inconvenienced us, I wasn't inclined to offer her one. Besides, as I said, she told me she'd made her own arrangements.
Are you sure she left?
What kind of question is that? Ottar asked, bridling. Of course we're sure. She said goodbye and we haven't seen her since.
Christian looked at Olaf, waiting for her to answer. She was silent at first, then said, Yes, she's definitely gone. She took her belongings with her. Her parents used to hear from her regularly, Christian said. So when she didn't ring at the weekend, they started to get worried. Haven't they been in touch with you?
Yes, they have, Ottar replied. And I told them the same as I'm telling you. I simply can't understand why you put yourself to the trouble of coming all the way out here. We could have answered your questions over the phone. You can see for yourself that the girl has gone.
I'd need to take a walk around the island to be sure on that point. Videy is quite large, isn't it?
3 kilometers from end to end, Ottar said.
The biggest island in the bay, Olaf added.
And I expect there are plenty of hiding places.
Well, Olaf said, there's our house, and the mansion, of course, and the church, at the old school, too, and...
I don't think we need to list all the buildings on the island, Olaf, Ottar intervened. Let the man do as he likes if he feels obliged to make sure. Though I can't imagine why on earth he thinks Lara would have been hiding on the island for the whole weekend.
How was she? Christian asked.
How do you mean? Ottar countered. Was she in low spirits? Is there any reason to believe she might have been hiding something, keeping a secret from you?
Ottar opened his mouth to answer, then seemed to think better of it. After a lengthy pause, he said,
There was nothing wrong with the girl. She was simply bored of being here with us. Well, good riddance, I say. We'll be more careful about choosing our help next summer.
I see. At any rate, she hasn't turned up at her parents' place, which raises questions, that's all. Of course, it's always possible she left here on Friday and...
Ottar interrupted.
Possible? I'm telling you, she left. And anything that may have happened afterwards has nothing to do with us. There's been no news of a boat going down, so it stands to reason she must be somewhere.
No, I'm sure we'd have heard if something like that had happened, Christian said.
The trouble is, there are no reports of any boats coming out here on Friday, though that doesn't rule out the possibility that someone came and picked her up.
Did she live here in the house with you?
Where else would she have lived? Ottar asked impatiently.
Could I see her room?
Ottar shrugged.
It's upstairs, but there's nothing to see.
He showed no signs of budging, but Olaf rose to her feet.
I'll take you up, she said, her tone a touch friendlier than her husband's.
Every stair creaked in the old wooden house. The guest room was small but reasonably cozy, with a sloping ceiling, a bookcase, and a dormer window with a view of the sea.
Did she bring the books with her? Christian asked.
Oh no, those are ours. We put books in all the rooms. It creates a nice atmosphere. My husband collects them. He's a barrister, as you're probably aware, quite well known, actually.
Christian was indeed familiar with the name. He nodded.
Ottar wanted to cut down on his legal practice and devote himself to academic work for a while. We're planning to try and live here, more or less, in the summers. It's good to be near...
She trailed off, looking away. Did she take all her belongings with her? Christian asked. All of them, yes, Olaf said. There's nothing here. Did she say anything to you? I'm sorry? Lara, before she left. What do you mean? How did she explain her decision? Olaf hesitated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.